Welcome back to part two of cam chest installation on this 2010 CVO 110 cubic inch motor. Now that you have everything out, uncovered again, we're going to pull the spark plugs out on the other side, jam this thing in high gear, which is six for this one, so we can turn the motor over, and we're going to check out what's called the crankshaft runout. Very important. If you have too much runout, you want to stay with a chain drive, and if it's way too much, you might have to dig deeper into your motor. But here we're going to make the decision whether we're going to go gear drive or chain drive. Now you can see we have our tool mounted to the face of our cam cover mounting surface, and our dial indicator gauge slid right in top. Very special, it has a ball on the end so it can roll evenly. I'm going to turn this over now. You can see the dial indicator gauge moving there, and it's showing me about 4.5 thou run out, which is definitely going to be a hydraulic chain cam setup. Now that we have our parts, and I like to keep a few different sets in stock so that I'm ready to go, I'm going to lay down some clean white paper towel, unbox all our parts, lay them out, inspect them, clean them, and start assembling. As I'm cleaning parts and reassembling them, I like to reassemble them with my assembly oil and get them ready to put back.
You've probably heard me mention before in my videos how I like to use liquid thread sealant.
You can see how small some of these holes are inside your engine. Up in here, you can see how Teflon tape would plug those holes off very easily.
Even our push rods, we like to completely disassemble them. You can see how hollow they are. They carry a lot of oil. This supplies oil to the top of your motor. If there's any crap in there, one of those holes is plugged, or if there's dirt in there, it's going to wreck a lot of stuff. I'm going to put a little oil on your threads when you reassemble them. Especially important for these fine thread applications. You're gonna take some time double checking everybody else's work. It's very important, because somebody else's bad work can make you look real bad too. This is how you assemble your push rods, tube, collar, spring, washer, O-ring, other tube, done. Collar, spring, washer, O-ring, fancy chrome tube, done.
Ever since I quit drinking, should love these kombucha. So now you can see, we've got everything cleaned up. Boiled up, oil pump, cam chain tensioners, boil them up. Get everything brand new that's ready to go. The only thing we haven't unpacked yet is the lifters, and that's because we're going to measure the lifter bores to see which lifters we need in each hole. If we need bigger than standard, we won't be needing these.
Live till I die. Think about tomorrow. Live until I die.
So now I'm going to show you how to measure the lifter bore, the hole that the lifter slides up and down in, so that you have the right size lifter in there and have the proper oil pressure in your motor and enough oil feeding the top end of your engine. First, you're going to take a sheet of paper. Standard lifter is 0.842. You can draw a picture, all four holes, rear, front, motor side, so that you can orientate which holes are which.
These are the balls from fueling that we use for measuring the strip bore diameter. If you can see that, each ball is precision size and probably the perfectly round ball you'll ever see in your life. I like to lay them all down on a clean piece of white paper towel so you can see if there's any dirt. I like to lay them all down inside order. You can see such a minimal amount of difference. Then you're going to take your first standard ball and drop it down all four holes. Obviously the standard is too loose already. Then you're going to take ball number two. Drop it down. So fairly loose. Now we're on to ball three. You see, it's just a really light touch. Kind of like you're putting a feeler gauge somewhere. Really light touch. That's how you want the ball to feel. Oh, this one's too tight. That one won't go. That one will. This one.
Oh. We're gonna write down all our sizes. You can see I've done that already. And then we're gonna go back to the bench.
So I hope you guys can all read this. Standard lifter size is 0.842. Oversized lifter is plus 0.001. Simple math, add that up, end up with 0.843. Same thing, oversized lifter number two is 0.0015, bigger than stock. So you add that up, 0.8435. Now this is the clearance you want from your lifter to your lifter bore, 0.001 to 0.0015. So I like to keep my lifter a little bit on the tighter side. Obviously not too tight, because then you end up with galling, or you end up with a stuck lifter if it's hot. But a standard lifter with this clearance would be this size hole. So basically we go up here and have a look. These two here are going to be standard lifters. .8440 was the ball that went through this rear inside hole. So we're going to be using plus 001 on the inside ones. Hopefully that was explained properly.
Good morning. So the next step now, that what we're going to do is put our inner cam bearings in. If you have a look at your cam bearings,
they have two sides, a side with, that's hard to see on the camera, but this side has stamps on it and this side has no stamps. You can see one side is squared off with the stamps and the other side is rounded.
The way the inner cam bearings go in every time is the rounded side goes in first. And your letters and numbers always face towards you. Cam bearings also get set to a certain depth. On the twin cam engine, the inner cam bearings get set from the face of your outer engine case. They get set 3.1 inches deep from the edge or the face with the numbers. And the way we do that is we take our install tool, which will be bolted here like this. We take 3.1 inches and add the thickness of the plate. So let's get this all set up and then I'll show you how to install it. Take our plate, put our threaded install tool in there, whatever you want to call it. Yep. The install tool comes with two sides. Just find which side your bearing fits on properly. This is for the newer ones, smaller end is for your older inner cam bearings. Slip that on there. Cam bearing on there. And then we hold it up there. Put your screws on to hold it onto the face. So now you want to push your cam bearing in a little bit at a time. You can use a little light to shine in there. Then you take your caliper. In this case, it's set to 3.472 inches. You just measure along the inside of your hole here to the edge of your cam bearing. You gotta go just a little bit deeper. Not much. We've got our front inner cam bearing installed. We're gonna do the exact same with the rear. When you're measuring, I like to unbolt my plate. Flip it over. You want to make sure you measure straight on. There we go, that one's perfect. If you measure at an angle, you're actually measuring longer and your bearing will not be set to its right depth. Always clean the oil off your tools every time you put them away. And when you pull them out to use them, clean them again. Not only is a clean tool a happy tool, but you do not ever want to have any dirt involved when building engines. Cleanliness is one of the most important things, and most guys get too lazy when it comes to cleanliness. Find a way to set yourself apart from everyone else. Now what we're going to do is put the three O-rings back in that I told you guys to make notes of earlier. Those back in. I'm going to put a bunch of assembly oil that we mixed up on our bearings, on our crankshaft. I'm going to slide our oil pump back on.
Now that we have our oil pump in, we're going to somewhat assemble our cam plate.
So now we're going to assemble the cam plate. I got these fancy little blocks from Jim's here with holes in them. I'm gonna lay the cam support plate on top there. Rear cam is the one with the longer splined end on it. Put some assembly oil on here. Slide it in here. Make sure it spins nicely. Pull it back out. Now what we're gonna do is line up the chain marks.
You can see here the dots on the teeth and the dots on the end of your cams.
That's how you want them lined up when you throw them in to the cam support plate.
So now we've got the inner cam chain tensioner. I like to take these apart, put a little oil inside the piston plunger. They come with new hardware. Just a tiny little bit of red Loctite on each one. Slide her into place. Take your torque wrench. Set it to 100 inch pounds. Now we've got that assembled up. If your camshaft got turned, now you want to make sure that your marks are still lined up with the front camshaft. Put a little oil on there. You put your 100 thou spacer over top of it. And your new retaining clip over the end. And make sure it gets seated properly. Personally, I like to, when I do a cam install, I like to cover all my cam lobes and my inner bearings with the product Moly paste. Now we're going to slide our cams into the motor assembled in our cam support plate. Put a little bit of oil, assembly oil, on your pinion shaft. Carefully slide everything together, making sure all your O-rings are in place. I'm going to put all six of your outer cam support plate bolts in with a little Loctite, and your S&S oil pump will come with new bolts. I'm going to put a little red Loctite on all of them. Slide that together. Now that you have all 10 of your bolts in there, you're going to go around and tighten only your outer cam support plate bolts, which are numbered in the order that you're supposed to tighten them as a star. Once again, we're only going to torque down the outer ones. You've got your outer bolts torqued up and your oil pump 4 bolts are only hand tight loose. You're going to put your engine in high gear with the spark plugs out and turn it over 2 or 3 times. What we're doing here is centering the oil pump on the pinion shaft. Everything should spin over real nicely. Then you can torque your oil pump bolts the same 110 inch pounds in the numbered order S&S put on the cam plate. Now that we have all 10 bolts tightened up, we're going to double check and install our drive gears. Now what we're going to do is check our rear cam end play. You can see it moves in and out. We're going to take the spacer that was behind the rear cam sprocket, and we tore this apart and reuse it to start with. There's no need to time the motor at this time because we're not installing the chain. I'm going to put both on there without any Loctite yet. I You probably can't hear it on the video, but there is end play there because you can hear it clicking. I'm going to take a straight edge machine finish. Make sure you push both sprockets in as far as you can. Lay it flatly over your pinion shaft sprocket surface and take a 10 thou feeler gauge. And here we have more than 10 thou, so we're going to need to use a different spacer so that we have a maximum of 10 thou. Now that we have the correct spacer, we're going to pull the bolts out again. And the reason we do the end play and set that up here with the straight edge is so that we get the maximum amount of life out of our chain and so that it's running true at all times. And you see your timing marks lined up properly. And you can also see which cam we're using. Now we're going to take our gear locking tool, slide that in there, and put our bolts in. I like to use a little red Loctite on both. And just run them in there. Camshaft sprocket bolt is .35 foot-pounds. Crankshaft bolt is .24 foot-pounds. I like to always double check everything. Pull your locking tool out. We're going to install the outer cam chain tensioner. Pull your block out. Make sure you put a little oil in the piston there and where your shoe rides. A little red Loctite on your new hardware. Run them in, tighten them to 110 inch pounds. I'm gonna put a little bit of assembly oil on your chain. Not quite necessary when you're doing the hydraulic cam chain tensioners. But you always want to just see when you look through the holes, see how much you can slide that cam cover up and down and left to right. Make sure that you got clearance. You're changing parts inside your cam chest. Some of it might be sticking out farther, so you want to make sure the chain's not rubbing on the cover. Same as everything else. Star pattern, 110 inch pounds. Now, we put our lifters inside this pot of oil in a tray, and we're gonna hook up a vacuum canister until we don't see any more bubbles coming out of our lifters. Then we know our lifters are full of oil and that they are bled.
See how much air is being sucked out of this canister.
While the lifters are bleeding, we're gonna put our oil filter back on, our drain plug back in, and we're gonna put 3.5 liters in the oil pan, and we're going to throw about 0.5 liter of brand new oil, AMSOIL 2050, inside the cam chest. That way, when we first start this motor up, there's going to be some oil for that pump to grab right away.
Now, while our lifters are bleeding, we put the oil back in the motor. We're going to spin it over. We're going to feel and see how easy it turns over, and we're gonna listen for anything that may sound out of the ordinary. Now,
We're going to carefully put our lifters back in.
Lifters, the way they're designed, have one hole in the side here. That's where the oil comes in. They only have one. And on a twin cam, it doesn't really matter. But as a rule of thumb, when you put both lifters in, I like to have the holes facing each other.
When I slide my lifters in, I like to use these magnets from Nine Finger Fabrication. That way you're not dropping them on the bearings, on the balls, creating flat spots. Once you've got a set of lifters in there, you want to put this anti-rotation pin back in there so that you know those two holes in the center stay facing each other. Now we're going to put our tappet cover gaskets in. Front and rear are the same, just flipped over in a different side. Put our covers on. The covers are marked front and rear, but they only go in one way, so you'll figure it out. Now we're going to insert the S&S Quickie push rods in the tubes and slide them up inside the motor. When you're using S&S Quickie push rods, it doesn't matter which push rod you use where, because all four are the same length. Wiggle them around a little bit just to find how they're going to go in there the best. Put the bowl in there nice and easy once you find the right spot. So, also, we've got oil in our cam chest already, about a half liter. We've got the pan full of oil. So now when we do a push rod adjustment and we're turning the motor over with the rear wheel, we're actually starting to prime the motor already. Our pump will start filling up with oil, filling the oil filter, cam bearings, crank bearings. There's lots of different ways to adjust push rods. I'll keep it real simple for you. You don't have to Google it all online. From zero lash, you're going to adjust your push rods 1/8 to a quarter turn max. First, we're gonna adjust our intake push rod. So we're gonna grab a hold of our exhaust push rod and turn the motor over until we just feel the exhaust push rod starting to open, meaning the lifter coming up. That's where we're gonna stop. Then we're gonna fully extend our intake push rod to zero lash, which means push rod is fully extended to the point where it's just making contact lightly with the rocker arm and the top of the lifter, and there is no up and down free play movement. For S&S Quickie push rods, you're going to need a 1/4 inch wrench and 2 7/16. What we're going to do now is hold the bottom rod and turn the top one 1/8 to about a 1/4 inch turn. Then we're going to hold our top rod and our bottom rod carefully with one hand. To adjust our exhaust, we're going to turn the motor over until the intake valve is just about closed. Sometimes you may have to lower your rear wheel down to hold it in place. So when the intake valve is almost closed, that's when we're going to set our exhaust push rod, fully extend our exhaust push rod to zero lash once again. And then we're going to do the same adjustment procedure as on the intake. We're going to do all four push rods exactly the same way. Now you can put your bike back in neutral. Put the spark plugs back in.
Go around. Make sure that all your O-rings are seated properly.
Properly. We're going to snap our covers back into place. Just use a small flat screwdriver. That's all there is to it. Once you have your two covers back on the back, put a little dielectric grease on the throttle body connector. This is the one that opens your throttle body flapper, butterfly valve. Snap it back into place. We'll do the front ones.
Now you can see we have the air filter back on. We have our throttle body plugged in, and we have the oil in the motor, which we've all done earlier. The spark plugs are back in. We're going to reinstall this handmade 2-in-1 stainless steel exhaust system from Red Thunder, made in Italy. And then we'll fire this baby up.
Now, when you're installing your exhaust system, you don't want to just put one part on, tighten it up. The only part of your exhaust system you want to tighten up is your rear clamp, your plate here, because this muffler will close. Don't tighten up these brackets, don't tighten up these nuts. Just put everything together all at once and snug it up a little bit so your pipes can still float, and then they'll sit where you want them to sit. The first part of tightening up the exhaust system is going to be the nuts at the flanges on the heads. And then we're going to tighten up right by the collector here, because this is a three-piece pipe where they come together. We're going to tighten these up. And that'll be, I should mention as to why we slowly tighten everything up. Nowadays, I see a lot of posts online, Facebook, people complaining about poor-made pipes, shitty quality manufacturing. You know, I see people complaining about their pipes cracking at the collectors. And I personally feel that a lot of times that's installation error. Because if you install this exhaust system slowly and allow the pipe to sit where it wants to sit, I don't think you're ever going to have a broken collector or exhaust stud broken off. Now the next part we're going to do is retie our O2 sensor wires up under the bike. Also make sure that you keep into account any sort of movement in your engine mounts, vibrations, sharp corners, hot pipes, because you don't want your O2 sensor wires to get rubbed through. If you do, your bike's gonna run like crap. We're gonna take a clean rag. You wanna make sure there isn't any blood on there, grease, anything like that. Wipe your exhaust system off. So when you start it up, you don't get any funny staining from oil or fingerprints, that sort of stuff. All right, now that you've checked all your work twice, you've got oil in it, we're gonna do the initial fire up.
you guys could hear it on the video, but as soon as we fired this thing up, the lifters only ticked for a couple seconds and it was instantly gone. Quiet. Obviously it's winter here in Canada. We can't test drive this bike right now, but I don't think we're going to readjust these push rods. We're gonna send her home. Put the bag cover on. We're gonna put the rear bag on, plug all the wires in for it. And this bike is equipped with a ThunderMax EFI module. So we're gonna go in, I'm gonna pull the seat off, we're gonna plug in and do a little bit of tuning, change the base map on it. And we're gonna send this one home. Later on, we'll do another video about how to install a ThunderMax EFI module. That is our engine management system of choice. And I recommend to everybody that if you have a Harley-Davidson motorcycle, to run a ThunderMax EFI module. It will change your world for the better. Thanks for watching. If there's anything you'd like to know, email me or put something in the comments about what you'd like us to see and do. And please like and subscribe to our channel. And we'll see you guys next time with the next video. Thanks for watching.